Welcome to Weekends with Whitney. Coming up in today's show, the woman behind Baton Rouge's oldest animal organization, Cause. At 100 years young, how she's still improving the lives of man's best friends, and how World War II brought it all together. Then, you'll meet the man who wrote this song and hundreds of other top hits. Find out his key to success as I tickle the ivories with music legend Jim Peterik. But first, at any age, Holly Reynolds' perseverance and passion is enviable. At 100 years old, it's remarkable. See how her work overseas in World War II led to a living legacy. Chloe may not realize it, but her owner, Holly Reynolds, has worked like a dog to give all animals a better life.
I think they're more than worth it.
At 100 years old, she spent 80 of those fighting to protect animals. Growing up in Covington, she never had a dog. In a surprising twist, World War II would change that. But first, Holly got a master's degree from LSU in 1941, an achievement only 1% of women held. A year later, teaching at a junior college, lives drastically changed.
While I was there, Pearl Harbor happened, and the Red Cross tried to recruit me right away.
She didn't go.
My mother's mother had just died, and my father had died the year before that. And I was an only child. And I just felt like I ought to wait. So I waited another year and went. I went over in 43. They asked you what area you would prefer to go to, and I said a warm area like North Africa. So they sent me to the British Isles. And I was in Edinburgh the first 3 months in a what had been a hotel. And the Red Cross had taken it over, and they had facilities for servicemen and women to come and stay overnight if they were on leave. It was like a R&R.
Holly was in charge of the entertainment.
Putting on dances and getting volunteer girls to come and dance with the fellas. And I took them on tours to different points of interest. And an important thing to do is listen. They love to talk about home and their girlfriends, and it was important to hear what they had to say, you know, for them to get it out.
3 months later, she was stationed in Northern Ireland.
There was entirely different, and I loved it. It was a small town like I was from. It was stationed there for the 5th Division, the Red Diamonds.
One memory there she can't erase.
I can remember them marching off when I knew they were going to Normandy.
Thousands of those U.S. soldiers would never be seen again.
They marched away, and we knew where they were going.
Holly would go to Wales, then England. Along the way, she fell in love.
Oh, I married a Yankee from Michigan.
The Red Cross discouraged it.
You had to get permission from the Red Cross. They try to talk you out of it, but nobody was going to talk me out of it. I had to go to London then to get permission. And so when they realized that you're going to go ahead anyway, he said, well, you need to go and look at the dresses.
Wedding dresses from women in the U.S. for Americans getting married during the war.
So I married in a borrowed dress, white satin, a veil and everything.
But after the war, their love turned sour.
When we got home, nothing was right ever. It was not a wise thing for me to do, but as I said, nothing was going to change my mind at the time.
She headed home to Covington.
I was really in a bad state, very depressed. You know, my whole life had fallen apart.
Then a different kind of love scurried in.
I don't know what happened to make me go and get a dog. But I see the dog up there on the left.
I do.
That's Dandy. He was born on the 4th of July and was named Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Dandy helped Holly find happiness again.
I'm still trying to pay back the help that he gave me. It was just wonderful.
Holly packed her bags and worked for the Red Cross again, this time at a Georgia hospital. Dandy went too. But the Red Cross discouraged this too.
We were supposed to live in the nurse's quarters, and you couldn't have a dog in the nurse's quarters. So I rented a room in town, and they didn't like that. They want you to be 24/7 Red Cross. So they transferred me to North Carolina, to Camp Lejeune, and the same thing happened. I rented a room in town. So after about 3 months, they ordered me to come to Atlanta to headquarters.
They handed Holly an ultimatum.
This is not working. You're going to have to decide between the dog and the job. And I said, oh, I'll decide for the dog.
Holly never even hesitated.
I didn't have to think twice. I left the job.
After all, there are a lot of jobs, but only one Dandy.
Was well qualified, you see, from LSU.
Sure.
And that wasn't going to be a problem. So I quit and I went home.
Holly went to work in hospitals and helping animals. When Dandy died, instead of mourning, she got moving, becoming an animal activist. In 1979, Baton Rouge's SPCA shut its doors, so Holly moved here to open a humane society.
I was working on a spay-neuter program before I got here. I was working with some neat people nationally who had an organization promoting spay-neuter.
She needed volunteers. Smiley Anders came to her rescue.
Smiley Anders had started his column in June of 79, and I called him up in August and asked him if he'd put something in about it, and I got 30 calls.
The Capital Area Animal Welfare Society, known as CAWS, was born. It's now the oldest local humane organization and only no-kill shelter in Baton Rouge. Holly's considered the mother of the modern humane movement in Louisiana. She inspired others to action.
At least 6 other organizations have started from people who started in CAWS.
20 years after starting CAWS, Holly started a foundation.
My father had left some property, and I sold it and put the money to start a foundation. It's called Holly Reynolds Foundation for Animal Welfare.
It's another living legacy.
The principle will stay the same, so it'll go on and on when I'm gone.
So will the multitude of state and national animal welfare legislation she's devoted decades fighting for, even today at 100.
After I was president, of course, I realized that the state laws in Louisiana were antiquated. We didn't even have a law against cockfighting.
She'll never forget being in the Capitol when the law finally changed.
Representative from Mandeville was nearby, and I remember throwing my hands up and going and grabbing him. I was so excited.
Holly's still tenacious, working on new legislation for next session.
When you work on a bill, if you can get half of what you want, you do it well, you take it and say, we'll build on this.
She's built a national reputation. At her 100th birthday party, the president of the National Animal Welfare Institute flew in from Washington, D.C. to surprise her with this award, celebrating her life as a humanitarian and centenarian.
I was really thrilled that she would do that.
Holly insisted, no gifts.
I said, 100 years old is nothing I need. But if you want to bring pet food, you can bring pet food. And you'd think, at this age, you know, you wouldn't be able to do much. So sometimes I think the Lord is keeping me here so I can continue doing things like that.
If you'd like to honor her 101st birthday with some pet donations of your own, I'll be sure to let you know when and where as it rolls around in December. And still ahead. I'm your vehicle, baby. The man behind some of America's greatest music, Jim Peterik, as Weekends with Whitney continues.
I love you, I need you, I want you, got to have your child.
Louisiana's old state capitol educates the public on Louisiana's rich history and the democratic process through exhibits, programming, and the arts. The museum is dedicated to advancing the collection and preserving this national historic landmark. Visit LouisianaOldStateCapitol.org.
Welcome back to Weekends with Whitney. Join me as I sit down with the man critics hail as one of the best songwriters and musicians in America. Jim Peterik lives and breathes music. Hold On Loosely is just one of hundreds he's written.
My theory is that if you write a good song, it'll remain, it'll stay. And if you write a good lyric that has a little bit of wisdom to it, it'll have even more legs. And Hold On Loosely was again inspired by my wife. Yeah, that's when she dumped me.
Right?
Which was the best experience in my life because I learned so much. Part of the reason she dumped me is that I was getting too possessive and too like controlling. And hey, you can't look at other guys and stuff. You gotta hold on, but you gotta hold on loosely. Give everybody room to breathe, man. It's the only way to do it.
Wow.
And they always come back.
You know, it's not just about couples. When I hear you sing that, really, with your children, with your job, with your family, it just,
good
you
point.
Know, just
let go
yeah,
a little bit.
Love, but not suffocate. Jim wrote that song for 38 Special.
It's so damn easy when your feelings are such to overprotect her.
As well as their first big hit, Rockin' Into the Night.
To the night, rockin' into the night. Ooh, ooh, rockin'.
And their first number one single, Caught Up in You.
I'm so caught up in you, little girl.
But Jim's written plenty of songs for his bands too, including Survivor. He founded the rock group and wrote 6 of their top 10 hits, including Eye of the Tiger. It won him a Grammy and an Oscar nomination. He thrilled Tiger fans in 2010 when he sang it with the LSU band in Tiger Stadium and the PMAC. It's always a crowd favorite. However, his favorite is this one.
It means so much to me. A lot of times we search for something that we already had. And for me, it can relate to myself in a lot of ways.
One thing he never had to search for was his passion. Music lessons started on the piano at age 6. It was in his blood.
My grandpa played concertina. He's from Prague. Uh-huh. My dad was born in Prague, moved to Chicago like many Czechs. And he was a sax player. And my dad had the sweetest vibrato on his saxophone. Oh. And the women, I noticed how the women would just look at him. I go, I like that. I want to be up there someday, you know? Not that women were the only motivation for music, but helps.
Yeah, and for most guys, it's right up there.
It's right up there.
He wrote his first song at age 11 to impress his girlfriend, Laura.
It had nothing to do with Laura, but I wrote it and I sang it for her, and she was like, new respect for Jimbo here, you know?
Did you get a kiss?
No. But it was called Hully Gully Bay. It was like a Beach Boy thing.
Oh.
It's really terrible. Come with me, my babe, where the sea is rocky and the tide is hot. Come with me, my babe, where the seagulls rock and the riverboats flap. Yeah, yeah, hey, hey. Come with me to Holly Gully Bay, where the sea is choppy and the waves are rocky. The Holly Gully seagulls are winging on with. Oh, come with me, my babe, to place called Holly Gully Bay.
At 14, Jim joined school friends in the band The Ides of March. It would be key to more than music.
I was 17, she was 15, and I was standing in line to see our favorite group, the Turtles. Oh. Imagine me and you, I do. I think about you day and night. It's only right to think about the girl you love and hold her tight. So happy together. So we're waiting in line to see the Turtles, and I see a gaggle of gorgeous girls, and they're all together talking, chatting, you know. But there's one that just had a light around her, you know. And I just kept looking at her, and I'm thinking, she's way out of my league. I was shy.
Really?
Really shy back then.
Okay.
Yeah. So all of a sudden she turns around and says, aren't you Peterik? I said, yeah. And I just saw your band, The Ides of March, last week. You guys were great. Music brought us together.
Their breakup would help create music history.
There was a period for about a year where she decided she didn't want to date me anymore.
Oh.
She was the first girl I ever dated. I was the first guy she ever dated.
Oh.
So she wanted to kind of see what's out there. Well, she just threw me for a loop, big loop. I had the blues, man, I was. My baby left me, yes, I left behind her. You know, and the Ides of March are going, come on, dude, snap out of it, you know? So one day she started calling me again. Yeah, but only for a ride. Because I had a 64 Valiant and she needed to go to modeling school, right?
Right.
And okay, maybe I'll get a kiss or something. Well, no kiss. Happened again, no kiss. I said, you know, all I am to you is your vehicle, baby. Yeah. And I was like, that could be a cool song, man. And maybe if it goes number one, she come back, you know? I'm going, let's see. I'm a friendless stranger in the black sedan. Won't you hop inside my car? I got pictures and candy, I'm a lovable man, and I can take you to the nearest star. I'm your vehicle, baby, take you anywhere you want to go. I'm your vehicle, woman, and I'm sure you know that I love you, I need you, I want you. I got to have your child, break out in heaven, you know I love. Ba-da-ba-ba-da. Well, if you want to be a movie star, I'll take you to Hollywood. But if you want to see this like you are, I think you really should. I'm your vehicle, baby, I'll take you anywhere you want to go. I'm your vehicle, woman, yeah. And I'm sure you know that I love you, I need you, I want you. Got to have your child. God in heaven, you know I love you. Ba-da-ba-ba-da. Well, check it out.
Oh my God.
It went number one.
Yeah.
Guess who starts calling me again?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Jim, maybe we should try it again for real this time, you know? And I let her hang on that phone for a good 3 or 4 seconds. And I said, sure. And we just, man, went straight ahead, and 44 years later, man, we're still happy together.
Your career is a record in and of itself, but the fact that you've been married 44 years is a record in the music industry, too.
Yeah, any industry, baby.
You're so
right. You know, I'm telling you, they ain't easy for anybody. And there are temptations, just like anybody,
sure.
On the road and this and that. I never fell into it.
How did you not fall into it?
I just felt I got something way better. I ain't gonna screw it up.
Oh,
you know,
it would have hurt her too deeply.
Well, it would have hurt me.
Vehicle not only topped the charts, it's reportedly the fastest selling single in Warner Brothers Records history. Its popularity still crosses generations. A fan in his 30s dropped this off at my house when he heard Jim was coming over.
This first Ides of March album is a favorite of mine. Also, I read Songwriting for Dummies, which I wrote, in college, and I've got to thank you for that. If not, it not only made a better songwriter, me a better songwriter, but a better, more productive artist in general. Clay, wow.
Your inspiration.
That's what it's all about. You know, giving back, man. And when I hear those stories, better than all the royalty checks I could ever get. Although they ain't bad.
Jim's royalty checks are so much, he doesn't have to work another day in his life, but he loves it. He just released another album, Fearless, with his latest band, Pride of Lions. But in the silence of this lonely room, by the corner of the rising moon, start to wonder if it all makes sense. I miss those days of innocence.
Very proud of this record. It's literally, it just came out, and All I See Is You is the first single, and we have a video, and that really reflects that story I told you about meeting Karen.
Aww.
And everyone else melting but her, and she's all I saw.
He still loves performing live too.
I love to get out there, and it gives me fuel for my songs, you know, just hearing what they're responding to. What it keeps me vital.
He performed with his original band, The Ides of March, 2 weeks ago at the Spanish Town Mardi Gras Ball.
I always say this at the Mardi Gras thing in Baton Rouge. I'm usually the wild dressed guy.
Uh-huh.
I just blend in. I'm the underdressed guy.
But you continue to write good songs. You know, some people, like, they write a couple of hits and then they just go dry. Your well has never been dry.
You know, part of the clue is I have a great faith. Mm. And I feel that, it's all from up there, you know. And I pray every day for inspiration. And it comes. And that's for me, the key. And enjoying life. And I'm always collecting ideas, always.
Great God in heaven, you know I love you.
You can find his latest album on iTunes, Amazon, or his website, jimpeterik.com. More of Weekends with Whitney after this.
Each morning in Baton Rouge, we rise to meet opportunity. We carry the weight of responsibility proudly. We choose our paths. We move fast and we fly high. We light the way for others to follow. We make it happen. But what really matters is what happens when we land at home. Baton Rouge Metropolitan Airport. Fly easy.
Discover your art of living at Dixon Smith Interiors. With 10,000 square feet of inspired interiors, it's easy to bring beauty home. Create a unique interior that reflects your exterior. Translate what you love into where you live. For 60 years, Dixon Smith has refined the art of style, space, and comfort. You're a work of art. Your home should be too. Embrace your art of living at Dixon Smith Interiors in the heart of Baton Rouge. Discover Dixon.
See that angry soccer mom over there giving the referee two earfuls? Well, I'm the human dislike button, and I see it too.
Championship rule section 2, part 1B. If a team does not display quality sportsmanship during the regular season, they may be barred from future sports opportunities.
Gotta remember, even though they make convincing canaries, referees are people too. It's important to keep your cool and use sportsmanship in every situation. I'm the human dislike button, but one thing I do like is following the rules. To learn more about me, go to breck.org/HDB.
Atlas Foundation Repair, fixing your foundation problems for more than 30 years while preserving and protecting your trees. Thanks for sharing your time with us here on Weekends with Whitney. We hope to see you back here again next week. But until then, we leave you with this.